Yeah, I mean, if somebody comes up, I said, somebody starts playing a riff, like me and CJ would be writing something, I go, that sounds a little Steely. And he'd go, yeah, it does, doesn't it? I said, let's run with it. Let's go for it. You know, because I love Steely Dan. I mean, you know, I mean, if they're not going to hire me to play on their record, damn it, I'm going to write my own Steely Dan song. Mm-hmm. So it's a running joke I've actually had for many years. It's one of the few things I wanted to do was play a guitar solo on a Steely Dan record. I played with Donald separately and Walter separately, and I'm a big fan, and we've met, and I love those guys. I mean, Jeff Picar was in Steely Dan when we were in high school. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's like one of my favorite all-time bands, you know. So, I mean, it's an homage. You know, I didn't steal anything, but it's meant on purpose to be like, yeah, here's my Steely Dan kind of song, or here's my kind of Band of Gypsies, Hendrix-y kind of song, or this reminds me of this. You know, Jeff Beck, I mean, it's all my favorite music. I'm inspired by all my favorite music, and it comes out, you know. I produced a record back in 1996, 97 that never came out, and I'm very sad about that. But in the middle of it, we got about six or seven tracks into it. It was really coming along great. And then Jeff changed directions. The techno music was hit him real hard, and he wanted to follow that direction. And he's the artist. I was the producer. I mean, you know, at the time, Tony Hymas wrote some beautiful music for us to play. And I was just sitting behind the desk, you know, kind of helping it all along. It was so awesome to just... you know, watch Jeff play and work. But we had been friends for a long time prior to that, you know. And I kind of threw my name. I said, why don't you let me do a couple tracks? And they liked the idea. And then it just kind of like it just fell apart. And, you know, Jeff's the kind of person, once he's done with something, he doesn't want it to come out unless he finishes it and okays it. But I will always have, and he promised me never to let it out on the internet, and I never did, you know. I mean, occasionally I'll play something for somebody and say, you can listen to this, but I can't even let you have a copy of it or anything. And I've kept my word to that, you know. He's one of the greatest. Because him and Dave Gilmour, you know, I kind of got a lot of vibe from those guys, you know. But then again, I listen to all different kinds of music as well, you know. Yeah, actually, I worked on Lee's record, Six String Theory. There's like 26, 27 guitar players on it, all styles. I was very honored. Lee and I go back to when I was a kid, and he really helped me a lot when I was a young session player. And we've stayed close friends ever since. He called me up and he goes, Luke, I want your help on this. I go, really? Man, I'm honored. He goes, yeah, I want you to produce me, write some things. So I wrote a couple things, co-produced three things, played on some stuff, brought in a lot of my friends, you know, the more the rock guys, you know, and the more the, you know, and he invited me along. It was such great fun. And we were recording live in the studios, Tal Wilkenfeld on bass, Vinny Caliuta, Jimmy Johnson, Will Kennedy, Larry Goldings, Paulinho da Costa, you know, I did with Slash, Neil Sean, Andy McKee, the acoustic genius, great guy. And, you know, I just was, we'll see. I mean, it's getting great reviews, and it's getting played a lot, starting to sell. We'll see how it all goes, you know. I mean, I always love doing these weird, quirky gigs. And Lee and I go, I just love my dad. He's a brilliant musician, a great guy. I got paid my wages, and that was it. You know, I don't get any royalties. If I got royalties off that, believe me, I'd be laughing right now. But I don't. Steve Picaro wrote Human Nature. You know, he gets royalties. But the funny thing about the Thriller album and us, you know, like, Toto had a lot to do with that record. But you never hear anybody say Michael Jackson and Toto. You never hear people say that together. Well, maybe you do, but, I mean, generally, like, you know, look at Human Nature. That's a Toto song played by all the guys in Toto with Michael Jackson singing. Beat It was Jeff Picaro and me. I played bass, all the riff parts, all the rhythm guitar parts, and Eddie did the solo and Michael sang. The duet with Paul McCartney was basically Toto and Paul and Michael. You know, but nobody ever says, you know, Jay-Z does a cover of a Toto song. Nobody ever says Jay-Z and Toto. Techno songs are written. They go to number one. They sample my voice, my song. You never hear somebody say, I mean, I don't understand... what the aversion of that is, but you know, at the same time, you know, I guess I gotta put my ego aside and just go, yeah, I was there, I was a part of those records, and maybe history later in 50 years from now, somebody will go, hey, well, what was wrong? Why, those guys were actually pretty good, what the heck, you know? I'd love to work with Peter Gabriel on something. I love it. I mean, you can hear this little influence of that in the opening track, the way it starts out. It's kind of like this very atmospheric thing, and all, you know, before it gets rocking, it's very, you know, Peter Gabriel inspired. I just love it. I just think he's one of the greatest artists out there. Yeah, I love the French. God bless the French audience. Let me tell you something. You guys have been so loyal, and you were on early, and it was a, you know, we sold out Bercy. We sold millions of records here. You know, there's such passion. Whenever we play, people have tears now. There's, you know, multi generations. We play now, like people come like their kids and the whole thing. You know, we have a very, very strong positive love for the French people, and thank you all out there. I really mean that from the bottom of my heart and soul. You know, we've followed my career as well as Toto's, you know. Plus, I love France. I mean, I can't wait to go out and have dinner tonight. You know what? Toto's never going to do another album again, like a new studio album, but we are going to do a few dates, and I think if we do those dates, we tried to get a French date. But there was no venue available. There was no festival that would have us. The festival season was over. I think this time they're going to go out of their way to make sure that if we do come back together for a few weeks this coming summer in 2011, France has to be on there. It has to be. It's one of the biggest markets we have. Well, Steve Picaro, I mean, that was the best part about it for me, was Joseph and Steve. Carl came back after 22 years, and with Paige and me, that was like the four high school friends. Because Joseph, even though he was our second singer, he was a singer in high school. Like, he was a friend. I was in a band with him, his brother, and we knew each other. We grew up in the same neighborhood, so we have a different camaraderie. Plus, he can really sing again. I mean, he's got all of his voice back. You know, and he wanted to come back and prove that to everybody that... Because at one point, you know, we were all doing drugs and doing crazy shit, and he lost his voice, and it didn't come back for years. Mm. You know, and then we found ourselves in a precarious position at the end of Toto, where Bobby's voice was really messed up, and not from drugs, but just from years. And I just couldn't do it anymore. I just couldn't, you know, you got to have a really strong singer who's going to sing those old songs and nail it. That's what people want to hear. So when we did it this summer, people were flipping out because it sounded, we had two great background vocalists that we brought out to really, because it was all real. There was no hard drive shit going on. There was no bullshit. It was really, the band was Steve and two keyboards on both sides of the stage, Steve Picaro and David Page, with those sounds, the real shit, and me playing. It was as close as we get to, but it was bittersweet because we didn't have Mike with us. Mm. You know, but Nathan East is a brilliant bass player, and Simon came back, and he was in the band for 17 years, and he brought a lot of life to it, you know, so it was really cool, and we had a good time. It was good fun.